Okay, hello everyone and welcome to our Facebook Live session. I'm Kasia Wozniak and today we're going to talk about English vocabulary profile. So basically we'll tell you how not to be lost with words with English vocabulary profile. And I have two fantastic speakers today. Olivia, hello.
Hi.
Hello. And Graham, hello.
Hello. Hi.
Is everyone okay? Are you okay today?
Yes, yeah. Fine, thanks.
How are you?
Well, I'm very well. Thank you for asking. Olivia is kind of our guest speaker. She comes from Cambridge University Press, which is not that far, basically. It's just opposite across the road. Before we start, can you just tell us a few words about you and while the audience is joining us? And as always, tell us where you're joining us from. Olivia, how about you?
I'm Olivia Goodman, and I'm the Senior ELT Research Manager at Cambridge University Press in the ELT department. And our team kind of is there to make sure that our learning materials are informed by the latest research in language and pedagogy.
Wow, sounds very interesting. Well
done. It is very interesting.
Yes. And Graham, a few words about you.
Oh, okay. I'm the European Research Manager in the research department at Cambridge Assessment English. So I work on a variety of different things, but one of the main things I work on is to do with the CEFR, which we'll talk a little bit about later. And before working here, I was a teacher of English as a foreign language, working in many different countries. So I've also had that teaching background as well.
That's good. Okay. And before we start, just to say that we have people joining us from Thailand and Italy and Spain and Russia. That's great. We love international audience. Malaysia as well. Nita is saying she's happy to learn new things, so that's great, it's brilliant. Okay, I think we're ready to start, and I think Graham, you said at the beginning you will tell us a bit more about CEFR.
Oh yeah, okay, yes? Sure, I'll begin with that then. So before we start talking about what the English vocabulary profile is, we need to start with the CEFR, the Common European Framework of Reference for Learning and Teaching and Assessing Languages, and that helps us put everything into context. So you might already be familiar with the CEFR, in which case, great, but if not, I'll just quickly go over the main basics of it. It's a framework which has lots of descriptors in sentences or phrases that describe what a language learner can do when it comes to learning a language. And we're not just talking language generally, we're also talking about language specifically in the different skills, so in reading and writing, for example. And these descriptors are set at different levels, so you can tell or you can describe which language level you are at. You can start from the bottom level, which we call pre-A1, and then it goes up A1, A2, B1, B2, C1, and C2 is the most proficient language learner. And you can use that to describe your language ability, as I said, but also to compare your language ability. Now, you might be comparing your language ability with somebody else, but you're also comparing your language ability between different languages. So I'm B2 German, B1 French, for example, but also comparing your English language ability, for example, in those different skills. So you can say, well, okay, I'm B2 speaking, but actually my writing is a bit weaker, I'm B1. So that's the CEFR, really useful framework for learning languages. The main problem is that it's designed to be used across many languages. But we know that certain things, such as vocabulary, such as grammar, are different in different languages, and they operate in a different way. And so therefore, when we come to thinking about English, learning English as a second language, we can use the CEFR, but when it comes to vocabulary and grammar, we might need another tool to help us. And that's where English vocabulary profile comes in. So I'll hand over to Olivia, who knows a lot more about it than I do, to tell us a little bit about English profile.
Okay, yeah. So the English profile is kind of a program, a project that provides detail about what the CEFR means for English specifically. And that was put together by Cambridge University Press and Cambridge Assessment English. as well as some other collaborators as well. And within that, there are two tools, so the English Vocabulary Profile and the English Grammar Profile. And the English Vocabulary Profile, or EVP as we'll call it for short, tells us, it kind of describes what vocabulary items learners of English can do at each stage of the CFR, as Graham pointed out. And they're not just single word items, they can be phrases as well, phrasal verbs, for example, as well as telling us what different meanings of those words are at each stage of the CFR as well. This is all based on extensive research from experts at Cambridge University Press and Cambridge Assessment English as well. And that research looks at learner performance. So it's based on the Cambridge Learner Corpus, which is a database of language based on learner writing from the Cambridge English exams. And obviously they're leveled by the CFR, so we can have a look at see what language students in their exams are producing at the different levels of the CFR. But it's also based on other research as well, so how English is used by expert speakers, as well as academic word lists, for example. So we know that we can trust this resource because it's been compiled from various different research. So just to clarify that this resource is based on productive skills. So it tells us what learners can do at different stages of the CFR, not what they can understand, for example. So we need to be mindful of that when we're using the resource. So to sum up quickly, sorry, it's descriptive. It tells us what learners can do. It's you can trust it because it's based on extensive research and it's based on productive skills. And this is great because it's freely available and publicly available for you all to use.
So everyone can use it?
Yes, everyone can.
Is it free of charge as well?
It is, yeah.
Okay, great.
Great. Good. And we have the link, I think, to show you as well. We might put that up now and a few times during the course of our session today, just so that you've got it and you can use it. There it is. So www.englishprofile.org/wordlists. So what we'd like to do now is show you this tool, show you how you can use it. So hopefully we're going to get the screen up. Here we go. So this is the English Profile homepage here. And so here I am. We're going to play it. Yep. Okay. And so englishprofile.org/wordlist. And I'm going to go down here to EVP Online and click that. And that will take me into the English Vocabulary Profile, the main section. Now, you can choose British English or American English, and that's an important distinction to make. I'm going to choose British English today because I'm British, and I'm going to type in the word blue there as an example. I'm going to search for the word blue. By clicking on search. And when I click on that, that gives me a list of all the words and phrases containing blue that are listed in the EVP. You can see then the base words, so that's navy blue, or the different phrases that use blue. Sometimes there are different meanings and we have a guide word to help you understand it. And then the main thing is what level is this word and that meaning or that phrase at the CFR. You've got the part of speech there, so adjective, noun, or phrase, and then the topic, so sometimes it's categorized into different topics. Now, with regards to level, I'm going to click on level, and that sorts those words into the CFR level. So now I've got the same results, but sorted from A1 down to C2. And there are different meanings of the word or different phrases using this word blue, for example, going all the way down C1 to C2 with a meaning of the word blue, meaning sad there, so a different meaning. Also, you've got the part of speech. Again, it shows you the whether it's an adjective or a noun or a phrase. And if I click on that, then it sorts it into the part of speech as well. So I have all the adjectives grouped together now. There they are, up there. And then the noun, we've only got one in this case of blue, and then all the phrases are down here. So that's a useful search mechanism. So I'm going to take the main example of the word blue, the blue as a color here, and show you a few more things about this word blue. We said it's an A1 level, and it's an adjective, obviously. And I'm going to go and click on this details here, which will give me more information about blue. So here is our head word, blue, and it shows us again what part of speech it is, adjective. And then if I click on this button here, you can't now, but you will be able to hear the pronunciation of the word blue. Now, down below it, we've got the different meanings of the word blue with the CEFR level and what it means, in this case, blue as a color, the same color as the sky. If I click on the plus here, I get some different examples of how that word is used, both in the dictionary, so dictionary examples, but also learner examples. So how a learner, how an English candidate of Cambridge exams has used that word. Down here, we've got blue as a noun instead, and it shows me if it's countable or uncountable. So different part of speech now. And likewise, I can do the same. So just to show you, here is a dictionary example and a learner example of the noun blue rather than the adjective blue. And then down here, we've got this phrase, out of the blue, a wonderful phrase, I think, using blue as a noun. And I clicked on that. And again, just to show you a dictionary example of that phrase and how a learner has used that phrase in a test that they took. Now, you can toggle between those two views, between the summary view and the full view, if you like. That's just a different way of doing it, and that expands everything for you, so you can see all the dictionary examples related to that entry there in the English vocabulary profile. And then finally, I'm going to click on back to results, which will take me back to that initial screen there. Okay, so I hope that's been a useful overview of how to use the English vocabulary profile, just the basic functionality that you can use there. And obviously, we've used the example of the word blue, just because it was quite good at showing you the range of levels. You'll find that some words only have one entry, but some more frequently occurring words, particularly when they have different meanings, appear many times in EVP. Okay, so that's the basic uses of EVP. I'm going to hand over to Olivia, who will show you some of the more advanced features beyond my capabilities. So, Olivia.
Okay, let's have a look then.
Okay, get it up.
Okay, then. So nearly there.
Yeah.
Okay, then. So as you can see, the CFR levels across the top are here, and we can click on A2 and the food and drink topic there. And as you can see, you've got all the results there for food and drink vocabulary items at A2 level. And as you can see here, they're all the same. And if we click on part of speech, that then sorts the results page by the part of speech. So you can see all the adjectives are first. So white, for example, fresh, thirsty, and then nouns further down. As you can see here, lunchtime, for example. Okay, but what if we want to have a look and see some higher level vocabulary? We can just click on B1 And that you can see that A2 and B1 are selected. And you can see here that the B1 level vocabulary is integrated with the A2 words that you've just looked at. So you can see here some higher level vocabulary, for example, sour and roast in there as well. Okay, we don't want to have a look at that anymore. So you can just clear results and that then resets your criteria. So you're ready to go again on a different search. So let's then have a look maybe at C1 vocabulary and we can have a look at part of speech specifically. So let's have a look at adverb and then click search. And you can see here, as we'd expect, some C1 adverbs. These are sorted by alphabetical order. And then let's have a click on details again. And you can see here, there's just one entry here for continually. And we've got this word family box that you can expand and it shows you the different words that are associated with this word that you've searched for. And then as Graham showed earlier, we can click on the full view or summary view. And the full view shows you the dictionary examples as well as learner's examples as well. So that's just a quick demonstration of how you can use more of the features of the EVP.
Okay, thank you very much for those. There are teachers here that commenting that they would love to introduce it during their classes. Mm-hmm. So how useful can that be for both teachers and learners?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. It can certainly be useful for learners and teachers. In fact, if you've been watching that and you've got some ideas yourself of how you can use it, then write it into the chat box now. And if we've got time, we'll pull up some of them at the end. Obviously, I guess the main use of this is that you can check the production of what your students are doing, for example, the writing essays that they are writing, and check that the vocabulary that they are using is at the right level. So if you have B2 level students, you want to make sure that they are using B2 level vocabulary. Now, obviously, they're going to be using lower level vocabulary as well, but you want to be checking that they are getting a good number of B2 level vocabulary items in there.
And it's also useful as kind of a guide as to the level of language that you use as teachers. And if, for example, you're looking for a reading text that you want to put together yourselves, you can use the EVP as a guide, but please bear in mind that this is based on productive skills. So, for example, B1 level students are likely to know the B1 level vocabulary items in the EVP. So it is okay to have higher level vocabulary in there as well. And actually, it's probably recommended so that you can give them that exposure and so they can progress even further.
I think when you were talking about being a guide to your language, it made me think back to when I started as an English teacher many years ago. And I realized that I had to watch the language that I was saying to my students, particularly when they were a lower level, and I had to grade my language appropriately. Mm. So I think particularly for new or newer teachers, it's an excellent resource because you can check what you are planning to say, for example, when you are setting up an activity. Is that language at the right level that those students can understand? Now, definitely I take your point that the EVP is designed on what students can produce, so you can kind of notch it up a little bit and that's okay. But it's a good tool to just help think about the vocabulary you're using yourself as a teacher.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, it's not just about what your students are doing. It's give a guide for that. But it can also be useful for obviously for vocabulary activities. So if you're putting together an activity, for example, on food and drink, as we saw earlier, you can check so you know what level your students are at. You can check in the EVP what vocabulary items come up at that level, and you can see, okay, yeah, my students know these words, but they don't necessarily know these ones at the moment. So you can then include those ones in your next vocabulary activity.
Mm-hmm. Be aware, I think, that the same word could have different meanings as well. Yes. So not just if they, as we saw earlier, if they know the word blue, then they know all meanings of the word blue because there are different meanings to the word blue. So obviously be aware of that.
So definitely check the guide words and then click into details just to check that you've got the right sense of a word when you're including that in your activities, definitely. You can also use the advanced search to generate word lists as well. So if, for example, you want to put together a list of vocabulary items that have the suffix ly, you can go into advanced search and click on that as well and generate a list of words with ly at the end as well.
Great. And I think that feeds in now to how you can actually use it in the classroom with students. Again, if you have any ideas, please feel free to put it in the chat box. But just some ideas that we've had. So when students are writing themselves in the classroom, then you can get them to do that work, to have a look at EVP so that they can check their own level of language. If you've got a B1 class, for example, and they have a writing task, and they could check the keywords within their piece of writing to check, is it at the target level where they should be? So they might see in their piece of writing they've used the word happy. They can go to EVP, type happy in. I think you'll find it's A1. They realize maybe there's another word that can just demonstrate their level of language a bit more. So in pairs, they can think of synonyms, have a look at where those synonyms fall in the EVP. So maybe instead of happy, you could put delighted, for example. And I think that's B1. So that's an excellent way of broadening their vocabulary, particularly if they are aiming to take a Cambridge English exam, for example, and want to get to a certain CEFR level.
Yeah.
Yes, there was even a comment from someone that it will actually help to prepare to Cambridge English exams.
Yeah, because you kind of exactly.
Know
yeah.
You need all... You know, you can find the words.
Definitely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you can also use it as a dictionary resource, if you like. So you might already ask your students to make their own word list. So if they write down a new word that they've learnt in their lesson, and they write down the definition next to it, maybe an example, maybe the pronunciation. But you can also ask your students to maybe add the CFR level to that as well. And also collocations. So in some of the dictionary examples that we saw in the tool, you might have noticed that some of the words were in bold, and that indicates that it's a strong collocation of the word that you've searched for. So that would be really useful to add that to the word list as well that your students are writing.
Definitely. I think getting them to take hold of their own learning, to use this as a tool which they can access as well as the teacher, so that you could get them, for example, for homework to go home and to do a search on EVP and find a list of words in a particular topic, for example, if you're doing food and drink, you use that example. So come into the next lesson with a list of words at B1 level for food and drink. Then they can check which ones do they know already, which ones are new words for them, and that shows that those are probably the words that they should be trying to learn next, and also maybe have a look at the level above that to check, okay, to scaffold their learning, what can they be learning in addition to that? And then, you know, the world's your oyster with that. You can do all sorts of activities, so get them to design quizzes or word searches, whatever you normally do with vocabulary items in class to get them to reinforce that vocabulary. But I think the key thing here is that it really helps you identify which words they should be learning at a particular level. I mean, it's not a definite guide, but it's a really helpful tool.
Yeah, definitely. And just if they, to get them to become more aware as well of the different senses, as we've said before. So if they put together words they know already, just to check that, I know this sense of a word. I know that blue means a colour, but that's not it. That doesn't mean I've learned blue. If you then have a look at the different senses, then they can expand their vocabulary.
Definitely. Yeah.
Okay, so that's kind of our few ideas of how you can use the EVP in the classroom and how it's useful. But if you have any ideas as well, if you already use the EVP in the classroom, then do get in touch and let us know how you do that. And everybody else can see those as well, so you can share ideas.
We have a few questions, though. Are you happy to answer them?
Yeah. Yes.
Let's have a look. Yes. Aisha is asking, is it more useful for general English context, or could it be used for English for academic purposes?
Good question. largely general English, but because of the resources that we've used to compile the EVP, we have looked at some academic word lists, and some of the Cambridge English exams are academic exams as well. So I would think mostly general English, but you can use it for academic English as well, but it's not an exhaustive list. So there may be some other words and senses of words that aren't in there that are definitely useful for academic English. So do be aware of that.
Okay, great, thank you. Someone asked, that's Mohammed, how comprehensive it is, meaning how many entries there are.
I think it's about 27,000 entries. It is a lot.
The point is, there are some words not in EVP. Will find some words that aren't in there.
Yeah.
And I know you're constantly adding to the EVP.
Yeah.
So, but you may find a word that maybe it's too specialised or too technical or too high level even for it to appear in the EVP.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And that doesn't mean it's not a useful word to use or to learn. So we are constantly adding to it. And actually, you can get in touch with us. There's a feedback form if you do think there is something missing there that you think might need to be added. But as language changes, we are trying to update that as well. So for example, tablet at the moment in there is only the medication form, but obviously we want to add the tablet now. It's probably more used to mean a device. So we are looking to fill in some of the gaps and add more.
Chego is asking, do I have to subscribe in order to use? And I know that you don't need to, you just go to the website, but I thought it would be good just to bring it up so that people know you don't need to subscribe to it. You just go to the website, and the website is just on the screen now. Some ideas from teachers. So Sandra was saying, I love this tool. It's fantastic for word building activities.
Definitely.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And also for writing tasks in groups.
Mm-hmm.
Would you use that? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I mean, I think using it in groups is a lovely idea because, number one, you're just sharing with the peers in the group as well. Probably you've got a tablet in there that you can access EVP on, and you can be sharing. Particularly if you're thinking of synonyms, if you're trying to raise your level, you can pool ideas in a group.
Fantastic.
Is there going to be maybe in the future an app that people could have on their phones or tablets?
Ooh, good question.
Someone asked that.
Oh, that is a good question.
That was a really good one.
Well, maybe. I mean, as far as I know, that's not in the plans. But if it's something that teachers and students would be interested in, if we have the demand for it, maybe then we have reason to create one.
Fantastic. One more question, Ken. English vocabulary profile be used with young learners as well?
Another good question. because it's not, the compilation of the EVP wasn't based on young learner data. So I think it's hard to say that you can use the EVP for young learners, especially because some of the vocabulary that young learners might need or know. For example, dinosaur, I think, is quite high level, or it might not even be in the EVP, but that's something that we probably teach young learners. It's probably not the best resource to use for young learners, but that is something that we are working on.
But I mean, I think you can filter it by just A1 level, for example. And obviously, you don't have to be a young learner to be A1, you could be an adult as well, but that will give you a good starting place if you want to use this tool with young learners.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Definitely.
And just to say, someone else asked if that could be compiled into an app. so that people could use it on the phone.
Okay,
so
yeah.
Definitely
a new session. You've given me more work to do. I'll make a note.
I like this comment from Elizabeth. Did you spot that? Yes. Yeah, Didkovskaya. I'm creating an activity based on it for my lesson, which starts in 2 hours. Let's put it into action. Brilliant. We look forward to hearing the results of your lesson.
Yeah, please do let us know.
Absolutely. And I think with this positive accent, we can finish the session. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. And if you are getting the badges from the Open Badge Factory, this is the claim code. We'll also put it in the comments so you can note it down and save it for later. And thank you everyone for your comments. They were fantastic and great, and maybe they'll bring new ideas and new developments into EVP.
Definitely.
Thank you to Graham and Olivia for joining
us.
Thank you.
As I say, always give a like to our Facebook page, and then you'll get notifications about our future Facebook Live sessions. Thank you a lot, and see you next time.
Bye.
Bye-bye.